felt, did those things. She said that was her mom's chair and she didn't need it anymore and asked if we wanted it. So I said, sure, and I took it. She said she had some lamps, had like 5 lamps. And then when I told her, yeah, I'll take them, but I don't have, you know, I didn't have any way to haul them out of there. So I told her, you know, sure, I take the lamps. We're going to be having a fundraiser sale at the church. We're trying to raise money for our leaky roof. Oh, you're going to sell? Well, you know, I should really think about what I want to do with those. And so, and as I, you know, was saying, you know, we're doing the fundraiser, and the reason we're, you know, we got some maintenance things we need to do, and before I could say we need to fix our leaky roof, great, have a great day, nice, see you later. Cut me right off, pushed me out the door, and it was like, well, it's going to be real hard for me to do any more work for you. It was extremely rude to me, very insulting. And I don't know why she'd be insulted. I said, I would use your stuff to finance the church. You know, she seems to be against church stuff and financing church things, so... It was insulting to me. I know some people don't see it that way, but I do. And,
that's good to know.
So I don't know. I don't know. I'm sure she wouldn't have gave me the chair if she would have.
If she didn't know.
If she Well, good morning. It's good to see the usual crowd here today once again. And once again, it is very disappointing that nobody else has saw us worthy of their time. But nevertheless, we're going to stay in the Word of God and do our part. You know, that's the thing is where we could spend a lot of time looking at what everybody else is not doing or doing, and we can complain about the way we believe we should be treated or shouldn't be treated, but in the end, we can be good to what God has called us to be and do that. And that's, you know, some of the reasons I think our family will never be financially secure because we always see the need to help others and to be generous to others and to be kind with others. And for that reason, we value people. We value people's emotions, feelings, and circumstances more than we do our own finances, I guess, you know. And so let us begin and open with the prayer today, and then we'll get right into the characteristics of a good Christian, as according to what the Bible asks us to be, you know. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for allowing us to be the stewards of this great house. And we invite you in. We invite you to fill this house with your Holy Spirit, to fill each and every one of us with the fruits of your Spirit, so that this world may see the light that shines from us and see that that light is our love for you. So we thank you. We thank you for the wonderful people you do place around us. We do thank you for the people who respect and honor your word, your promises, and the goodness that flows from you. Thank you, Father, for all these good things. We thank you for the air we breathe, because we know it is your life. We thank you, Father, for the food we have, because it nourishes our body. And we thank you for the clean water we have to drink. Thank you, Father, for all these good things. We love you, and we pray that you'd spend today with us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
You search much deeper.
I'm gonna start the live stream here for us. You guys have any prayer requests or anything you'd like to talk about? Anything weighing on you?
I want to pray for the citizens of the United States of America, because this looks like we're going to hell in a handbasket. There's nothing we can do about it.
Yeah, that's
good.
Yeah. And, you know, that's the same thing Jesus and his followers and the people he was dealing with back in his day when he was walking the earth, you know, the Israelites and the Israeli nation of that day was feeling the same thing. They were feeling as if they were God-governed and God was their king, God was their protector. God was their provider, and they were a nation protected by God. And they found themselves in a place where they had to trust in God, even during a time when everything was going wrong, everything was going against their intuition, their logic, and sound thinking. We look into the world, and we can clearly see and identify the lie, and there's 80 million of us who see it and understand it and recognize it, and yet in all of it, we're seized in fear. We're seized and we can't do anything. And so it's just like Ronald Reagan once said, right? There's this guy and he finds himself on the edge of a mountain, and he goes and he falls off this cliff, and there he's hanging by a tree limb, right? And all of a sudden that guy starts praying, "Oh Father, help me, help me, help me, Jesus," right? And all of a sudden, after a few moments of silence, Jesus answers. Jesus appears and he hears the voice of God, and he says, "Well, if you have faith, let go." Guy looks down, sees 200 foot down the bottom of the cliff, and he says, "Well, is there anybody else up there I can talk to?" Right? But faith, and what is our faith in? And I agree, we need prayers, and that's why I believe in the message. This is why I believe in everything we teach and speak about here at our Father's House of Prayer. This is why I am utterly disgusted that nobody but you guys, and I love you guys, and I'm glad and thankful you guys come, but no one else in this community sees it as viable, valuable, worthy of anything. And everybody's got an excuse. Everybody has an excuse of why I don't have to. No. As a good Christian, it is Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. And that's it. That's it. I mean, we love Jesus Christ, and we love the forgiveness we find in Jesus Christ, because that gives us the ability to go to church and have sex every day of the week with any different person we so choose. It gives us the ability to go and become an absolute drunk, and nobody cares. It's okay, I go to church and I get to be a part of the choir and still have engaged in adultery against my spouse. That's why I love Jesus, because I get to be a part of the church and everything that goes on in the church, and I don't have to stop sinning. And yet the Bible says, turn away from evil. Leave evil. Leave the works of evil, because God has predetermined or said or has declared those who are engaging in the works of evil are not of God. And they have chosen to separate themselves from God. And that is the love of God. That's God displaying his love through free will. Love cannot exist if we don't have free will. It's not a reality, it's not real. In order for love to be reality, it must have the opportunity to reject it. Say, I don't want it. I don't want nothing to do with it. Because God says, as Jesus says, and as we say, the doors are open. Come. Come. Each and every one of you can come. It's up to you. Just come. And I will show you my love. Come. I don't have a locked door. Doors are wide open. Jesus says, I open a door that no man can shut. Come. The bride and the groom, they speak the same word. Come. And there's those who say, I refuse to come. In the same way they say, I refuse to obey the commandments of God. God says, if you love me, this is love. Your obedience to my commands. So Jesus says, love, this is love. You want to love me, then produce the worship I so desire. I desire you to worship me in spirit and in truth. What is our spiritual worship? That we would love one another through a sincere, genuine desire for one another. You know, that's the thing where everybody is out there preaching and attacking the church. And people who go to church as being religious. We're not defined religious. Because the same people who say I'm spiritual and not religious are the very same people who reject the presence of God inside the gathering of believers. This place is a place of broken people who believe in the love of God. That's why they come. That's why they come to church. And I've seen and heard people say, you know, if you're depressed and you have problems and you got all these issues and suicidal thoughts, you need to go to see a therapist. And That's what the church is. It's supposed to be a hospital for broken people, people with wounds, and a place where we can come and lick those wounds and bind up those wounds. A place where people can share stories about, hey, this is how I overcame those situations and these things. And see, we are the body of Christ. We're all one member of that body. And so, in order for Jesus Christ to manifest himself, his kingdom, in this world, on this earth, it is through our willingness to obey his commands. He says, the one who loves me is the one who's obeying my commands. That's the guy who loves me, and that's the guy whom I will manifest myself to. I will manifest myself to them. In fact, when the Spirit of Truth comes, the Holy Spirit comes and baptizes you, right? You'll know him because he lives in you. He'll be a part of your life. He'll even come and eat dinner with you. Christ Jesus and God our Father are one. He and God in him are one. And the two will come and live within you, and we will be one. And that's the problem with today is everybody, well, I don't trust going to church. Those are religious people. And yet if you want to find a good place to seek counseling, Christian counseling, godly counseling, group therapy, come to church. That's what it's about. That's why we're here. I mean, where we come to church and people all of a sudden say, I don't want to talk about the truth. Talk about anything and everything but the truth. And the truth is, we all are struggling. We all have emotions. We all have feelings. We have things we're dealing with. We got issues. nobody wants to admit that I got issues, I got problems, I'm dealing with something. We must, at some point in life, come to recognize and understand that if we want Jesus Christ to come into the world, to change it and to transform it into this thing that we all so desire, that then we ourselves must recognize our role, our part in it. And this is how Christianity, believe it or not, broke down the Roman Empire. An empire full of tyranny and lies and propaganda and the works of evil. It's how they broke it down. That they became the pillars of their community by doing the things Christ has deemed righteous and holy, and everybody who engages in acts of righteousness, you're of God because God is righteous. God is holy. Oh, I'm going to get healed. I'm going to find my healing from Jesus Christ. Indeed, you will. And we come to the Lord seeking refuge from the Lord. But why don't we believe that if Christ is alive in me, that then I should be the answer to the prayer? That's what astonished everybody when Peter was there in prison. And he's sitting there and he's singing hymns. Right? And there's people, and there's Rhoda, and there's all the disciples and that over in this house. And they're praying for Peter. And the angel of the Lord comes in while Peter's there in prison, unlocks the gates while the guards are sleeping, and frees Peter from his chains, and Peter, follow me, and he just walks right out as if he had never been in prison. There was nothing there to keep him from doing the will of God. And then he goes and he knocks on the door, and Rhoda is like, oh my God, that's the ghost of Peter. She's afraid. I don't even want to open the door. I don't know what to do. There's this man standing here knocking on the door. He looks just like Peter. I believed, and I knew Peter was back there in prison. What's going on here? And runs up the stairs, tells everybody, and everybody comes on down. And they were amazed. They were astonished. And why were they amazed, and why were they astonished? Peter was the answer to their prayers. They were praying for Peter, and they're praying for Peter to be free from prison, and here Peter stands knocking at the door. The answer to their prayers. That's what was astonishing. You ever thought or wondered, what doesn't God want you to be the answer to somebody else's prayer? That's the thing we use as an excuse to not do what God has asked us to do. Yeah, I see you're struggling. I see you're in trouble. I know you're in need of financial aid. So you know what I'm going to do for you? Pray. I'm going to pray for you. Well, if pray what? If you believe God should be providing financial aid, why wouldn't you just provide the financial aid? Why? If you know God knows what I need, why wouldn't you partake in fulfilling those needs? And this is the problem with when Jesus was around to our day today. Everybody says the right words. Your lips are very near to me, but your heart is far from me. You say all the right things, and many people paid the tithes and offerings and did all this stuff. But they wouldn't lift one finger to relieve another person of their burdens. And that's where we are today. We are being backed down and put in a place where our money, it doesn't even have value. No money has value, especially in America. Giving our money away to weapons of war, to countries who are absolute Nazis. I am not a supporter of Ukraine. I am sorry. I pray for the Russian soldiers and their safety. And that might shock you, and that might, but you gotta recognize and understand. The United States government, it was elected by us to protect us and our interests and our well-being. And there's for sure something evil going on, and good and righteousness will never do what it takes to right the ship. And so it's exactly what Dr. Martin Luther King said. So America will not be destroyed by evil people. They are so small. It's a very small minority group who are engaging in the works of evil. It'll be destroyed by good people who do nothing. Do nothing. Everybody was a good man back in the 1960s, but they still had the Jim Crow laws. Black people weren't men. They weren't men. And so it's good people who do nothing. And that's what the Bible says, and that's what Jesus says. Don't worry about the works of evil and what they're doing. The problem is what are you doing? What are we doing? So David says it like this. David, the second king of Israel, right? Some people saw a little shepherd boy. Saul saw his enemy. Goliath saw a dog. But God saw a king. First Samuel chapter 24 says it like this. When Saul returned from following the Philistines, he was told, "Behold, David is in the wilderness of En-Gedi." Then Saul took 3,000 chosen men out of Israel and went to seek David and his men in front of the wild goats' rocks. And he came to the sheepfold by the way, where there was a cave. And Saul went in to relieve himself. Right? Again, you're the king. And everything a king does is, and especially Saul, it all has to do with how you present yourself in the crowd, right? A king can't expose himself or make himself vulnerable. And, you know, if any man needed to relieve himself, he would find the nearest bush. But Saul and the Israelites come up with a great idea, the first outhouse. And so he goes into the cave to take a poo. And so he puts himself in a place of absolute vulnerability, taking off all of his clothes and everything, and so he can go and relieve himself in the cave where nobody can look upon his vulnerabilities. You gotta remember that Saul and everything Saul represents is everything the people wanted. The people chose not God. They chose to separate themselves from God. God was their Lord, God was their King, and they didn't want God to have authority over them. And so God gave them everything they so wanted, which was the opposite of God. And that's why he gave them Saul, an absolute narcissist. Saul's extremely selfish, yet very weak inside. The people of that day, including Saul, they judged everything they saw by appearance. And that's not changed. It hasn't changed a bit. Everything is done by appearance. And we judge others by what they wear. People, I don't want to listen to you because I don't like your hat. I don't want to listen to you because I don't like the clothes you wear. And so we judge everything as according to the outer appearance never looking into the heart of a man. That's what God does. He looks into the heart of a person, and he judges them by the things that come and flow from without, from within their heart instead of the outer appearance. Remember, Saul is bigger and stronger than any man of Israel. He's head and shoulders bigger than everybody. Saul gathers 3,000 men to kill David, to set himself in at war with the will of God. He knew that God, through Samuel, had anointed David to be the second king of Israel. This is not of my seed. This is not of my stock. If anybody's going to be the second king of Israel, it should be Jonathan, my son, or my seed, my children. So he fights against the will of God, and he's making a statement that the will of man is obviously stronger than the will of God, especially when we gather together 3,000 men. Now, David and his men were in the innermost parts of the cave. And the men of David said to him, "Here is the day of which the Lord said to you, 'Behold, I will give your enemy into your hand, and you shall do to him as it shall seem good to you.'" So here is the fulfillment of a prophecy that there would come a day when God would deliver David's enemy, and Saul is David's sworn enemy, and not because David was a bad guy or did something wrong, but because Saul found himself fighting God. Wanted to be God. He is chosen by God to represent the people as the people so wanted. The same as where we are today in our world. And yet Saul uses that authority to crush and destroy his own countrymen. Exactly where we are today. Nothing's changed. Nothing's new. He goes on to say, "Then David rose stealthily, cutting off the corner of Saul's robe, and after David's heart struck him, because he had cut off the corner of Saul's robe, he said to his men, 'The Lord forbid that I should do this thing to my Lord.'" When he says "my Lord" to Saul, "the Lord's anointed, to put out my hand against him, seeing he is the Lord's anointed." So David persuaded his men with these words and did not permit them to attack Saul. And Saul rose up and he left the cave and he went on his way. Now, what is that significant of? Why the corner? And because we refuse to acknowledge that we're talking about Jewish people. We're talking about Israeli people. We're talking about people who are grown up and accustomed to the rules and the things of God. So there's this tzitzi thing, and they're supposed to have this thing. So this is the covering that they're talking about. And it's his prayer song. And this is what identifies all Jewish people as being Jews, and Israeli people as being Israeli. Because God said, "Okay, that's what I want you to do. Make for yourselves a covering. Here's the covering." All right, and somewhere along the line, the word wings, this is a wing. These right here, this is the fingers of God. This is a tallit. This is a tzitzit. Hebrew words. These are the wings. So when God says, I will cover you in my wings. Right? This is it. Cover you in my wings. And this is what identified everyone. This is how everyone knew that you were dealing with a Jewish person or an Israeli person. Because Jewish people are only one tribe in the nation of Israel. Saul is not even Jewish, right? He comes from the tribe of Benjamin. So he cuts that off. This is known as the fingers of God, the hand of God. And those who obey the commandments of God are in his hand, inside of his protection. So when David cuts that off, I'm cutting off your connection to God. And then I'm replacing your connection to God with me. I am now your intercessor. I'm the mediator between you and God. And you want to get to heaven. You want to get to God. You got to go through me. Remember, David represents the Messiah, the chosen one. Right? Word Messiah is anointed. Jesus, the Holy Spirit. Jesus says clearly, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and nobody comes to the Father unless he comes through me. Cutting off everybody's connection or way to God. I am the mediator. There's no other mediator between man and God other than Jesus. There's no way to come to God unless you come through Jesus. And David has this realization. It dawns on him of what he just did. And he says, Lord, forbid it. I cannot kill this man. Now, if God so desired to kill him and remove him from my presence and to free me from the sin of Saul, so be it. Not my will, but the will of God be done. So Saul leaves the cave. David comes out and says, hey, Saul, look. I have the corner of your garment. God handed you over into my hand, and I could have killed you. But, as the proverb says, evil comes from evildoers. Wickedness comes from the wicked. I'm not evil. I'm not wicked. It's not within me. I cannot do it. I can't do it because I'm not like you. I'm not like you. And if I'm going to be like anything, I want to be like God. So here's the thing. I've cut off your connection between you and God, and I hold within you, in my hand, your salvation. And David says, this is what I want you to know, Saul. Even though you chase me around like I'm a flea, I'm a dog, I'm worthless, and I have no value. And you have set the nation of Israel against me. I want you to know God loves you. I want you to know God loves you. And it's for that reason I spared your life. Jesus says the same, does the same for us. Not for your name's sake, not because you were righteous, not because you were good, not because you do all the wonderful, great things, but because I want you to know God loves you. I do these things. And so when we have Christ alive within us, and we're people out there seeking refuge from God, Where are they going to find that refuge at? Where are they going to find that love at? Where am I going to find anything or anybody on earth willing to help carry my burden and to counsel me and to help me? Because here's the reality. When you go see a therapist, and our family has been to therapy, okay? We went that route. We tried it. We get it. We understand. The therapist loves money. The therapist loves money. And for $850 an hour, I'll listen to you. Now sit down, chump. First, let me see your bank. Let me see your bank account. Let me see your money. Because when the money runs out, I also run with the money. That's therapy. I don't care about you. I don't care about your problems. I have no empathy. I have no sympathy. I have no compassion within me. I have love for money, which is the root of evil. So you want to go and engage in therapy with somebody who has declared by action that I have enrooted in me evil. I love money. And so when I don't care what your problems are. How much money do you got? So why before therapy starts, did you bring your check? Bring money? But if you really wanted help, you'd come to church where there's a group of people who care about you, who have within them sympathy, empathy, compassion, love. Love for the person. That's why church was supposed to be important. It's the gathering of believers and who gathers us. Jesus Christ. If Jesus Christ is in the midst of two or more, there I am. There I am, right there, in the midst of two or more who have gathered in my name. What about 50, 20, 30, 10, 100? They all gather together. And then everybody up there who's non-religious. I don't go to church because I ain't religious. And I don't participate in tithes and offerings because I'm not religious. All of that is the rejection of the Holy Spirit. You don't believe in God. That's serving God in vain. Not, we always say, well, don't use God's name in vain. So you know, we leave church and we start using God's name as a cuss word. Everybody goes walking around cursing God with his name. That's not what the scripture is actually talking about. He's saying, don't use my name in vain. Don't claim I'm God. Don't claim I'm your protector and I'm your provider and I'm your refuge. Well, you're sitting there in therapy office getting counseling from somebody who's rooted in evil. Don't reject my presence here in the church. Jesus Christ could heal people, but you know what? Jesus Christ never does. It's never in the Bible this, that Jesus Christ came and he made the rich or the poor man rich and he enriched him with money. In fact, nowhere in the Bible does it say Jesus Christ gave anyone money. But Jesus Christ was rich. God, and all the richness of God and the fullness of God in flesh and the kingship and the authority of God. And all things belong to Christ. And yet he humbled himself to become very poor and took on poverty in order to enrich us so that we would be rich. We would be rich in kindness. We'd be rich in love. We'd be rich in empathy and compassion and sympathy. We'd be rich in the fruits of the Holy Spirit. And that's something, well, I don't know if I got much value for that. I don't know if I value those things. Really, the answer to my problem is money. And that's what everybody thinks. The answer to our problems are always money. Well, that's the root of our problem. Could you do me a favor and just turn the heater off, because it does make a bad buzzing noise. So back to Saul and David. Afterward, David also arose and went out of the cave and called after Saul, "Lord, my king." And when Saul looked behind him, David bowed his face to the earth and paid homage. David said to Saul, "Why do you listen to the words of men who say, 'Behold, David seeks your harm'? Behold, this day your eyes have seen how the Lord gave you today in my hand in the cave. And some told me to kill you, but I spared you. I said, 'I will not put out my hand against my Lord, for he is the Lord's anointed.' See the corner of your robe in my hand? For the act that I cut off the corner of the robe and did not kill you, you may know and see that there is no wrong or treason in my hand." Another act of, why did God choose David to be the second king? He had a heart for God. And what's inside of God's heart? A desire that the entire nation is protected. That everybody who belongs to the nation of Israel is protected. And David's saying to Saul, "See, there's no wrong, there's no treason in me. I spared your life." Goes on to say, "I have not sinned against you. Though you hunt my life to take it, may the Lord judge between me and you, and may the Lord avenge me against you. But my hand shall not be against you. As the proverbs of the ancients, out of the wicked comes wickedness. But my hand shall not be against you. After whom has the king of Israel come out? After whom do you pursue? After a dead dog? After a flea? May the Lord therefore be judge and give sentence between me and you, and see to it and plead my cause and deliver me from your hand." And David displaying a love for God, a love for the authority of God, right? Greatest verses spoken by man back in the Nazi Empire was what? "I did what I was told. I did exactly what I was told. And they told me to line up 6 million Jews and fry them in an oven. I did it. I did what I was told." That's exactly where we are in the United States of America. You listen to men, and you'll do everything you're told, but do you listen to God? David said, I will not listen to man. Saul listens to men, but I listen to God. And the commandments of God tell me to love others as I would have them love me. And I display that love. This is how I desire you to love me, Saul. In this way, spare my life because you're good. Protect over my life because it's the right thing to do. You don't always have to do what you're told. Instead, see the ultimate authority that comes from God. Again, we see here Psalm 142, Psalm of David while he was in the cave. One of those times he's all alone. That's something we can take comfort in. While we're in a problem, whatever our problems are, when we're separated from the rest of society and the norms of society, we can always come to God. could always find counseling with God in prayer, but recognize our part in this. Recognize, why is this a sanctuary? Why is this a place of refuge? And it should be because the presence of God is here. Psalm 142 says this: with my voice I cry out to the Lord. With my voice I plead for mercy to the Lord. I pour out my complaint before him. I tell my trouble before him. When my spirit faints within me, you know my way. In the path where I walk, they have hidden a trap for me. Look to the right and see. There is none who takes notice of me. No refuge remains to me. No one cares for my soul. I cried to you, O Lord. I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. Attend to my cry, for I am brought very low, delivering me from my persecutors, for they are too strong for me. Bring me out of prison, that I may give thanks to your name. The righteous will surround me, for you will deal bountifully with me. And in here, in side of the house of Christ, this house of God, in this house of prayer, we should find an abundance of righteous people who believe that within them are the good qualities people are seeking for. When they seek refuge, they seek it from us, just as David displays to Saul these things. I seek to show you refuge. I seek to show you the love of God. I seek to show you mercy. Even though you don't care about me, you've shown me no place of refuge, no help. Here I am alone and afraid. And yet still, he's able to display the fruits of the Holy Spirit. If we move over to Romans, we were in Romans chapters 11 and chapters 12 during our Bible studies of the last few days. If you missed that, go and find those studies. It's good stuff. It's good for all of us. And a great reminder, it distinguishes good, holy Christian behavior. And we, as being the pillars of America, or the pillars of society, the pillar of whatever country we're in or find ourselves in, what makes us the pillar are these characteristics. And so Paul lays it out clearly. Paul says clearly in the book of Romans, stop sinning. And everybody hates that. And there's a sense of rebellion comes within our heart when anybody says, stop sinning. Yeah. I want to hear about the love of God. You'll find the love of God in that act of stop sinning. Some people think that I judge others and I judge people, and nobody's judging anyone. This is the word of God, and if you're being judged, then it is God judging you. Because this is his word. This is what it says. It says this. We'll back up just a little bit. Romans 12, verse 9. These are the characteristics of a good Christian. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Abhor what is evil. Hate evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in the Spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be consistent in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. That's something we here at our Father's House of Prayer are trying to do, right? We have December 9th, anybody out there in city or town or community of Ray or Yuma County or wherever you may be, our Father's House of Prayer will be open December 9th. What time? 12 o'clock, noon, December 9th, on to whatever, Parents' Day Out. If Mom and Dad want to go and have a date and engage in a date, or they want to use time to go do some Christmas shopping, because we live in a small community out in the middle of nowhere, and if you want Christmas presents or things, you got to travel to another town or another place. We're offering babysitting. We'll babysit your children. And with that, we got some games, some arts and crafts, and lunch. We'll feed them as well. Why? Because we believe in the characteristics of what it means to be a good Christian. We desire to show hospitality. That's why our doors are open. Come on in. It's December 9th, or most days during the week. People all the time, you know, our doors are open during the week, and I only go to church on Sunday morning. What is this? Church open during the week? Well, yeah, I get it, and I understand. Well, I got a problem. Well, I'm going over here to Nancy, and I'm going, Nancy, can you help me with my problems? No. Oh, I'm going to go over here, and I'm going to see a therapist and extinguish myself with all my money. And I don't have no, and in the end, you know, they say, well, here's the answer to your problems. Why don't you purchase some drugs? Good old-fashioned drugs. Medicine. Not drugs. We'll just mask the problem. We're not going to deal with the problem. We're just going to cover the problem up with a little bit of drugs. I'll show you escape. I will show you pre-tribulation rapture. I got drugs. That's pre-tribulation rapture. I'll do anything I can to engage or be a part of the tribulation and the testings of life. How you plan on escaping these things? Drugs. I love drugs. They're the answer to my problems. I ran out of drugs and ran out of money and got all these problems. And you know where the last place you go to find help? Church. That's why it's so weird and it's so strange. Who has their doors open during the week? I don't go to church on Sunday. I go to church on Sunday so I could display some sort of righteousness and holiness so everybody knows I'm good. Instead of recognizing and understanding, the word hospitality is the same word as hospital. Hospital and hospitality are the same thing. So sinners come to church finding help and refuge. It's supposed to be a hospital for sinners, hospitality. We provide hospitality, right? These are things that define good Christians. It says, bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Repay no evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. Paul says, you know that story back there in 1 Samuel? Take it to heart. Put it in heart. Put it to action. In fact, Jesus says, these are the blessed. Somebody says, you know, blessed is your mother who bore you, who nursed you. Jesus says, no. Rather, blessed are those who hear the word and then put it to practice. And Paul says, you know that story back there in 1 Samuel chapter 24? Blessed is he who hears the word and then puts it to practice. That's why David was God's beloved. In fact, his name is Beloved. means I am loved. Goes on to say, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all, if possible, so far as it depends on you. Live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you will heap up burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Only light can cast out the darkness. Only love can put an end to hatred. You cannot cast out hate with more hate. And only love can do these things. And Paul says love is patient. Love doesn't brag. Love doesn't boast. Love is humble. It's selfless. He says, if I carry my Bible around with me all day long, and I know all the verses in it, and I dedicate my life to Scripture and the study of it, yet I have no love. I am nothing. If I speak in the tongues of these angels in a language that nobody could understand but me and God, and I have no love, I've gained nothing. If I offer myself as a living sacrifice and I walk through the fires of hell only to gain the salvation of another person, and yet I have no love, I am utterly bankrupt. And that's what we're seeing. Love is growing colder and colder all the time. Love is dying. And the thing that made America rich, that made America great, never was found in the dollar, in money. It existed because we loved one another. Loved one another. That's what made it great. That's what made it awesome. Now, Romans 13 says it like this. Let every person be subject to governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God. And those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has anointed. And those who resist will incur judgment. Again, Paul's saying, you know that story back there in Samuel chapter 24. Take it to heart. David says, I'm leaving you a living example by which I wished you would love me in the same way I desire to love you or to be loved by you. I'm going to display that love to you. Speaking to Saul, the authority, God anointed him. So somewhere in some place in American society, we must believe that there must be some people there who were anointed and placed there because God knows what he's doing. And even though we don't understand it, we shouldn't lean upon our own understanding, but lean upon God's understanding by trusting in God. Trusting in God. For rules are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain, for he is the servant of God,
an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be subject or in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of this, you also pay taxes, for the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Owe no one anything except to love each other. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law of Christ. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Love. So when we're full of anxiety and we're full of problems and focused on evil and the acts of wickedness, sure, we're going to lose heart. We're going to become worried. We're going to begin to question God's wisdom. But if we're too busy to be bothered by those things, because we're acting and doing all these acts and things of love, I mean, we look into television and how great and powerful propaganda is. And then when we walk out the door and we look around, there's only our neighbors. And if we love those neighbors as we would have them love us, there would be no reason for anyone to hurt you or to harm you or to destroy you. The answer to the problem is love. It's always been love. See, God is love. I had a conversation with a person who is filled with what I call was the Jezebel spirit, as they go around seeking people of authority, seeking pastors and prophets and people of God, and try to break down their faith. And I kept telling them, you say you know God, you know everything about God, and how everything spoken of in the Bible is just a form of control, and it's written by men, and that ain't God. God is over here. I said, well, okay, well, tell me about love. What defines love? They couldn't answer that question. They couldn't define it. And they tell me all these different things about how God is an alien race of people, and the aliens came and they pooped out human beings through their alien wombs and created a new alien race here on Earth. And but tell me about love. And you say you know God. Tell me about love. Define for me love, because God is love. And if you know God, then define for me love. Define for me God. Tell me about love. And that's kind of what David did with Saul. I cut off your connection between you and God. And my desire is to reconcile you to God. You have made yourself an enemy to God by seeking my life. But I want you to know love. I want you to know love. And I'm willing to define what love is by sparing your life through an act of kindness. Right? David doesn't say, "Hey, Saul, did you not read the Ten Commandments? What's going on with you?" Instead, he defines his relationship with God to Saul by showing him an act of mercy, an act of love. That's why we come to church. We believe in God's love. And if we believe in God's love, where am I going to find the love I'm missing in my life? In church. Because God is there. That's why doors are open. Why would I go to church during the week? Well, maybe if you put God first, you wouldn't be having the problems you're having today. How many times have we ever put God last? I go here, I go there, I go over there, I go back there. And when all of that has exhausted itself and proven unworthy, then I come to God. What if we put God first? Huh? Maybe we could avoid all those problems. Maybe. So, now let us finish up what we got here. Besides this, you know the time that the hour has come to you to wake from sleep. Paul's saying it's time to wake up. Right? Jesus didn't come so that you could come to church without guilt and shame, continue living in adultery, to continue living in sin. I mean, everybody hates the homosexual, but nobody wants to admit that debauchery is the same sin as homosexuality. And debauchery is the indulgence of pleasure. Of pleasure. Or alcoholism. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed. The night is far gone, the day is at hand. So then let us cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Cast off the works of darkness. Paul once again says, repent. He doesn't use the word repent. He says, stop doing evil. Do you not recognize and understand that Jesus Christ came into the world to put an end to the devil's work? To put an end to the devil's work. And if Christ is alive in us, then let us cast off the works of darkness. What is darkness? I hate my brother. I hate my neighbor. So the biggest problem within our nation today, in the nation of America, is the propaganda that is dividing us. And they are clearly saying, hey man, you're either a Republican or you're a Democrat. And it is the Republicans and the Democrats who are engaged in this war of propaganda. You guys are at war, and you're using us, the American citizens, as your pawns. I'm not an American. I'm not a Democrat. I'm not a Republican. I am David, God's beloved son. And God so chose for me to live right here in this land. This land dedicated itself to freedom. And yet the people of America are the least free people in the entire world. Least free people in the whole world. Put on the armor of light. let us walk properly as in the daytime, not in orgies, drunkenness, not in sexual immorality, not in sensuality, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provisions for the flesh to gratify its desires. What does Paul say? Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's where a Christian came from. The word Christian began as a derogatory term. Jesus babies. Call them Jesus babies. These people who want to be like Jesus. And each and everybody, there's that I can't stand it, and boy, you want to boil my blood. Come and tell me nobody can be like Jesus. So there's no need to even try. I'm going to try to be like Jesus because nobody can be like Jesus. And Paul and everybody in the New Testament say, be like Jesus. Be like Jesus. And would Paul ever ask us to do something he knew we couldn't do? Would Jesus ask us to do something he knew we couldn't do? Because Jesus says, this is the power of faith. I can do all things because Christ strengthens me. What does this world need right now? And everybody agrees, right? We need two things. We need love, and boy, we need Jesus Christ to return. And yet I say it every time and every Sunday and every week, be like Christ, and the world will know God lives in you. Nobody's ever seen God, nobody's ever seen the image of God, but if we be like Christ, we can be sure of this, God is alive in us. Put on Christ. Be like Christ. That's how Christians put an end to the Roman Empire. And Paul saying, you know, I surrender to the authorities and the things of Rome because God must ordain it, even if they cut off my head. They can't stop the word of God. And maybe the act of cutting off my head is what's going to solidify my faith and thereby make it real and make it great. As we started in the beginning, there's a man on the side of a cliff holding onto a tree limb, praying and begging God to deliver him from that situation. And Jesus says, if you have faith, let go. Let go. That's what makes faith real. That's what makes it a reality. See, people put their faith in the Bible and in the gospel, because everyone who partook in the writing of it was killed in a very horrible way. And all they had to do was admit their faith was a lie, and they could have spared their lives. Even if you take my life, I believe in the love of God. And there's nothing you can do to take that away from me. And so we are, be like Christ. You want to find God? You want to find answers to your problem? You want to be healed? Come to church. And you'll find refuge. You'll find healing. You'll find the presence of God. Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you. We thank you for your holy word. We thank you for your promises indeed. You are the God who provides. You will provide a lamb for us. You will provide instruction. You will provide counseling. Father, yes, you will provide our healing. In you, we place our trust. In you, we seek our refuge. So come, O God, and fill each one of us with you, your Holy Spirit, and the attributes of it. Thank you, Jesus, for hearing us, for loving us, and binding us together. In you, we found our love. We pray for the nation of America, the citizens of America. We pray for Ray, Colorado, and the people of Ray, Colorado. We pray for the doctors and the nurses who claim to know and have the wisdom to heal and to restore. That each and every one of them would do these things by the power of your goodwill. We ask you, Father, for your kingdom to come and be here on earth. We ask for your will to be alive within our lives just as it is there in heaven. We ask you, Father, for our daily bread. Fill us with nourishment. Nourish our spirit. Nourish our strength. Nourish us. Build us up. Encourage us. Fill us with your Holy Spirit so we may be able to put on Christ. Father, give us the strength and the power to forgive and to live our lives just as David lived his life. Give us the power to display to others a desire to love them as they love us. And so we ask for your forgiveness. Forgive us for our trespasses and our wrongdoings, our debts. And we also forgive those who have debts against us, who have wronged us, who doesn't see our value. Forgive us, Lord. Father, because you're good, lead us away from temptation. Lead us away from the desire to be angry. Lead us away from the desires to be frustrated and depressed and upset. Father, lead us away from all the things that are tempting us not to faith in you. In you, our trust is alive. You are our hope. Deliver us from the hand of evil. Because your kingdom is the power. It is the strength. It is the glory of our lives, and it will endure forever. Amen. For those of you on Facebook, unfortunately, we cannot share with you any of our music, but we are glad you were here with us today. If you're there in the community of Ray, come on in every Sunday at 9:30 right here at 4th and Birch. We are open, and the doors open at 8 o'clock. Come on down Sunday, and we're open during the week. If you have any struggles or problems, you can find us here. And remember, this is a house of prayer, and you're more than welcome just to come in, pray, hang out, fellowship, and find the presence of God. We thank you all, and if you'd like to help us financially, please do so. Send those payments to David Cecina at 4th and Birch, 250 East 4th Street, here in Ray, Colorado, 80758. Until next time, we'll see you later. For those of you there on YouTube, sit right back and enjoy this little bit of music we have today, as we believe It is God raining out His Holy Spirit, His words of love, into our hearts and our minds. Just sit back and absorb it and enjoy it. And we thank you also for joining us today.
One of my favorite things about Psalms, God, is how David cries out to the Lord. And we learn from the example of David and what he writes in the Psalms, it's okay to tell God how we feel. And Psalm 142 is one of those Psalms he writes when he's alone in the cave, on the run from King Saul. He's overwhelmed, he doesn't know what he's going to do, and just pours out his heart to God. I love Psalm 142, and I love that you're going to sing the words of that great psalm.
Wonderful song, and we hope you enjoyed it. And we read through that song, but it's a good, again, a great reminder that no matter where we are, no matter how hopeless life may seem, we can always come to God in prayer and bring to God our problems, because God is full of compassion, empathy, sympathy, love, and grace. And He has the know-how to heal us from our problems.
Amazing love that would come to me.
And he is so good, he is so wonderful, and if we can remember and remind ourselves that all good things are coming from God and all things are working together for the good of those who believe. Remember that and focus on that. Keep our eyes on Christ and Christ in us. Don't diminish that. That is a very powerful thing, and it's the most powerful thing in this world. Christ alive in us. Keep that in mind as we go through this week. I got one last song. It's kind of a short song, but we'll listen to that, and then we'll pray for the Lord's protection and go out and enjoy the Sunday. Here where we are, it is cold and windy. Boy, the wind is about ready to blow the house down, and cold, but maybe a nice warm hot breakfast would hit the spot, right? One of the rules here at our church is everybody who comes to church gets to partake in breakfast, and sometimes we go out and sometimes we have breakfast here, and we'll have to see how that goes or what we're gonna do, but breakfast is a part of our Sunday thing, the breaking of bread with one another and sharing in that soul food. So one last song, let us listen to this and we'll get going.
You
God is our defense, our righteousness, and we need Him. That's the greatest need right now in the earth today is Jesus Christ. We need Him. We need you. And that's why it's disappointing each and every week when people from this community don't show up. It's not that we're upset and mad that you rejected us. Sure, my feelings are hurt. We need you. We need you. That's what's disappointing about it. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We thank you that within us we have a need for you. Fulfill that need. Always be here. Always protect us. Protect over Harley and Taylor throughout this week. Protect over Ira and Davina as they travel to meet with Travis, and protect over Travis, Hannah, and Emma, no matter where they are. Protect over my mother, her heart, and her love for this nation. Protect over this community and the people of it. Protect over us, Father, because we need you. And in needing you, we pray and we hope to find that refuge we can only find in you. Thank you, Jesus, for your love and your grace. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, David, for that service.
Well, that's the thing is, you know, I was gonna do Romans chapter 13, but it's kind of nice because I didn't even read Romans chapter 13, and how perfect it fit for your prayers. So maybe God was speaking through you and reminding us that in our prayers He is very attentive, listening, and the answer is found in His Word, in our faith in Him, which Christ is the Word of God, alive in flesh. And that's what we are, and that's what we desire to be. And I think, you know, don't be worried and don't focus so much on the battle, what they're doing. Instead, focus on what we're doing and what we can do. And we'll find peace in that.
Yeah.
We'll find peace in that. So, what's for breakfast?
Whatever you're fixing.
Do you guys want to go out for breakfast?
Yeah, we can do that.
Sounds good to me.